My name is Giovanni Lambir, and I am the
coordinator. So we begin, I'd like to acknowledge that we are gathered today in the land of the Gadigal people, who are the rightful owner of this land, where the University of Sydney is built. And today is a very special seminar of our series called The Overseas Futures. It's actually our last one, and we have one of our earliest associates of Sydney Northern Network. So that's very nice. And it's Jean-Paul Gagnon, Dr. Jean-Paul Gagnon. He is assistant professor at the University of Canberra in politics, and he is a social and political philosopher specializing in democratic theory. He's also the editor of the Journal of Democratic Theory, published by Berkan, and also co-edits the Palgrave Macmillan book series called The Theories, Concepts, and Practices of Democracy. His research focuses on democratic theory, especially innovation in democracy, the philosophy of democracy and democratization, and comparative democracy studies. This research is supported by directly related inquiries into critical theory and the philosophy of knowledge. Key epistemic influences include post-fundationalism, post-universalism, cosmopolitanism, secret history of democracy, second modernity, and hybridity in theory. And his teaching focuses on democracy, Australian politics, comparative politics, and the politics of China. And today he's going to speak about an ongoing research project for some time now, and it's trying to test the project with us as well. And it's called Democracy-Generated Pluralism, and he'll be speaking for about 30, 40 minutes perhaps. And then we'll have even less.
I'll do my best to stay under 40.
If you go too far, I'll actually call it. And then we have some questions, and then we can change. Thank you very much for coming on board. It's great to be here. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Gio. Thank you for having me. Yeah, genuinely really grateful to be here and to have this opportunity to share a bit about this work. Listening to the bio, I'm reminded that I need to rewrite that quite badly.
Right.
It's now with the move to speaking in plain English, we have to apparently bury all of our sclerotic words.
I realize this room has a very strange acoustic.
Terrible.
Terrible would be the best way to describe it. So you need to speak up a bit.
Okay, I'll use the lecturing voice. Okay. Good. Well, this presentation is a distillation of what's turned out to be a much larger paper than anticipated. So at the moment the manuscript's sitting at around 11,000 words, and I'm trying to trim it down, but I'm facing some difficulties. It's programmatic in nature, so the piece is really about trying to set a research agenda, something that could direct me and hopefully any others who find this work interesting in future endeavors. So I'll just start out by pointing to some of these pictures. If anyone happens to Google democracy, so if you go to Flickr or something and you do the creative attribution commons things, you're not pirating anyone's work, and you punch in democracy, you'll notice that all sorts of different images emerge. And this is just an analogy for showing that the understandings of democracy are so diverse, just so many ways of coming at them. And that'll form the first recognition of this talk. So I picked this one right here. This is I know it's a bit hard to see, but there's an easel back here, and an artist has painted nested American flags, and he wrote, or she wrote, the word democracy using letters from different corporate branding. Another one up here, this is actually from the Museum of Nassau in the Bahamas. I would love to study pirate democracy for beach-related purposes, but they have this placard there called Pirate Democracy, and the claim is that pirates had been, putting to use, practicing the types of emotions and principles that we saw in the French Revolution. And they were doing this, decades ahead of that time. So, between electing their captains or standing them down on ships, they also had a deliberative process, not all of them, but some of them, deliberated about what happens if you lost a leg whilst swashbuckling. there's different remunerations if you use an ARPANET and so on. And the last one that I'll point to is just this image that came up of this branch. And the title of that one was Democracy, which was unusual. And you know, it evokes pluralism, and with the number of leaves, it's also very well lit, you know, reminding us of the transparency. And anyway, there's a, you can read into it quite a few different ways. So I only show these to give a bit of an artistic rendering of pluralism. And this brings us to our first recognition. And Dahl will kick us off. So in 1956, in a preface to democratic theory, he wrote, there is no democratic theory, only theories of democracy. And there are analogous statements again. Henry Mayo, in his introduction to democracy or democratic theory that was published in 58 or 60, he admits in the preface to the book that he tried, his instinct was to try to collect all of the different theories of democracy, understand them, and then you know, come up with his own definition that way. But by his own admission, he gave up. He said, you know, the task seemed endless, you know, it grew really confusing, and why bother? So the why bother statement comes back to Dahl. So Dahl says, you know, every definition of democracy that we have is to some extent arbitrary. Those are his exact words, to some extent arbitrary. And when you unpack that statement, the arbitrary is simply because there is no concrete, empirically grounded whole for what democracy means. So definitions are in a sense pulled out of an ether. And he qualifies the arbitrary with, to some extent, by saying, well, many scholars justify their definitions. We give historical justifications, etymological ones, comparative, phenomenological, whatever. There's a lot of different ways that scholars, you know, come about justifying why they use, you know, definition X in their work and not definition Y. Now, what's I just want to point out here is that this pluralism is, I think, unescapable. And it comes down to how we define knowledge. So on the first hand, if you create knowledge in a Platonist perspective, this is evoking, you know, ideal types, saying that there is something like a true democracy, a real democracy, you know, the only legitimate democracy. These types of absolutist claims are what we see in the Platonist tradition. Now in the 20th century and the 21st century, we really don't see too much of this language. This is more, we see a lot more of this in the 19th century and in earlier times. Now, despite people saying that this is the one and true democracy, well, if you start counting them in the literature, there are many claims to this, right? They contest each other. So all of these claims to the one and only democracy, that there's a plurality of them there. So in the Platonist sense, we can't escape pluralism. In the non-Platonist sense, and we can think of Aristotle perhaps as one of the earliest thinkers who said this. So Aristotle wrote that, you know, there are many different kinds of democracy, and democracy comes from that which has been said. And if we think about that again, from a left Hegelian perspective, if you like, thinking about where Aristotle was living, where he was situated, what time, what he means is probably that democracies emerge from what people say in the assemblies of city-states, and that there would be a variety of different iterations of democracy because of that. If you extend the non-Platonist mode of thinking, it basically gets us into this mode of thinking that democracies emerge at different points in time, in different contexts. Some of them will be considered legitimate for these people over here and in this time period, and for others not. Anyway, I don't want to spend too long on the preamble. It's just to say that from the Platonist and non-Platonist perspectives, it's pluralism all around. Yeah. So, what we do normally is recognize that there are, and I played around with my thesaurus here, it's not death by PowerPoint or anything, types of words to say that there are many ways of defining democracy. It's a common recognition. In the paper, I trace this back to the 1890s. So from the 1890s to today, every decade you find words with someone claiming that some pluralism exists out there. The biggest claim that I ran into was by Coldier and Levitsky in their 1997 paper, Democracy with Adjectives. In it, they claimed that there are hundreds of different ways of defining democracy. It was a bit of a throwaway line in the paper, because they were arguing something different in it. But the point here is that no one had provided a data set to justify these claims, that no one had gone and started counting. And we'll come to that later in the talk. The short of this is, and if you go through the lit, there is this multiplicity of ways of saying what democracy is, might be, or should be. And if there is a rule, then it's just something that holds true in the way that we come up with knowledge about democracy. Most of us recognize that there are X number of ways of defining it, and I give Y definition for these reasons, and we kind of move on. So that's, again, brings us back to Dahl and his saying that our definitions are, to some extent, arbitrary. Good. I think I've thoroughly fumbled my way through the preamble. I'll sit in this area a bit more, which is our second recognition, and this brings us to the work of Mielo Kurki. So Kurki, in a really nice paper in 2010, she explains how scholars of democracy recognize that there are, many different ways of defining democracy, giving it meaning. But they don't engage with that pluralism. This was a big point in her paper. And if you think about the literature on democracy promotion, we see this type of critique come up quite a bit. So the United States, the EU focuses principally on democracy promotion in its literature. If you look at China or Russia for autocracy promotion. And the critique here is that in foreign policies, we're getting this tendency from powers in the world to put forward particular models at the expense of others. And where they're being exported, there's a lovely adjective called laser-guided democracy. Really nice bit of literature there, but when certain types of democracy are being exported, other people in the world, in the Middle East, they feel oppressed by this. And they've got their own understandings, their own iterations of democracy that, in their eyes, are equally legitimate and should be given the time to grow and to be nurtured without oppression from hegemonic power. So we can understand this is a bit of hat tipping. Well, this picture comes from the Wikipedia entry on hat tipping. And that's how I understand what Kurki wrote, that we start off our works, we tip our hat in the direction of pluralism, and then we move on and do our own thing. So if that's what happens, then my question is, how do we go about engaging with this plurality? And that's what drives the paper. So one way to find this engagement is to try to understand its extent, right? So it's an empirical question. And the way that I approach it in the paper is to count adjectives. Now you can come up with different ways of constructing bodies of knowledge about democracy. So some people describe it without using adjectives. Some people use words that are synonymous with democracy, like demarchy, democracy, polyarchy, and then they talk about it this way. I decided to focus on pre- and post-positive adjectives because they're the most common. So a pre-positive adjective appears in front of the word democracy, and a post-positive appears after it. And it's the most common by virtue of the fact that that's what adjectives do in the English language. They're describer words. They inscribe meaning into the word, the noun, democracy. So the way that I started to do this is, this brings us back to what, 2014? Yeah. So I came up with an organic method. I was just
reading different democracy-oriented works, for all the research I was doing, I started keeping a catalog of all the different adjectives, pre- and post-positive, that I'd run into. Over a number of years, that made the list grow to about 507, and we put that up with the City Democracy Network online, which led to some really interesting discussions with people who found it on the net. And anyway, when I reached that 507 point and I started having these discussions, it led to more, I'd say, better developed lines of inquiry. So you start to realize that, a good example is green democracy. Right? Why is there a green democracy in this data set and not other colors of democracy, right? So we started to...
Green.
Yes, as in green.
Green.
Yeah, but the acoustic is green.
Can you guys hear me in the back? Or should I stand up?
No, I can, but I have a little bit here.
Okay.
So you can say
jazz.
I'll try to play, what's that, squash with my voice.
It's a bit like that. That's why they put this thing in.
Not at all. Green democracy was there, and so I started wondering, what about other colors? And, that led to looking at red democracy, white democracy, black democracy, blue democracy, yellow democracy, rainbow democracy, brown democracy. These all exist in the literature. I started to think of antonyms, right? We have representative democracy. What about unrepresentative democracy? I started to think about the synonyms of words, like we've got good democracy, then what about benevolent or beneficent or positive? And I started following these types of rabbit holes, and over the last couple of years that led me to find 600 and something additional adjectives. So the total that I'm at now in this paper is 1,216 different adjectives of democracy. So that's the number that exists, since it's a real, a type of artifact, if you want. You can print out all of these different works and fill the room with them. The cross section is in this table. That's fine, is that visible? Okay, so when I found these 1,216, I then wanted to know a little bit more about them. So my research assistant, if I can speak, research assistant and I put together a piece of software that looked very slowly through Google Scholar and Google Books. So these are the two most comprehensive databases that are available to me, at least, in looking through scholarly work. And the program looked for these 1,216 in those two corpuses. And what it returned was the number of publications that each of them are found in. So that's how they're ranked. The top 1%, so that the biggest adjective that we found by a wide margin, by about 60 or 70,000 publications, is American democracy. And we started wondering, why American democracy? Why is this the most pronounced descriptor used for democracy in this particular body of literature? As a side point of methodology, Google Scholar started in 2004, Google Books started in 2005. Scholar is quite capacious. They have things called web crawlers or bots that go through the internet and they pick up journal articles mainly, but they also pick up what's called gray literature. So things like, publications in The Conversation, blog posts or more academic-oriented news posts. Things like the monkey cage and that will appear. So it is quite, casting quite a broad net. And Google Books, it depends on partnerships with authors, publishers, and libraries. So that's, the extent of it. I think both of them do provide, again, for me, the most capacious containers for knowledge in the English language. Now, when we asked why American, we thought maybe it's the superpower effect, that perhaps because it's been so dominant in the 20th century, and perhaps because you know, according to Giovanni Sartori, political science has been, you know, in large part dominated by people who are based in the United States. I don't know. It's something that needs further thought. But it's just, you know, an example of finding. I'm more interested in the back end of the list. So, you know, torpedo boat democracy. That's a thing that exists. You can't make this up. Sardinian democracy. You know, what is Sardinian democracy? Does it differ to Sardinia's democracy? So here we've got the etonym. So it's the etym of all. Well, you've got the statonym, which would be Sardinia's democracy, and that's a possessive noun and doesn't figure in this work. And then you've got the etonym, which is Sardinian democracy, and it figures. So you come up with these questions like, do they differ? How do they differ? Why do they differ? Why does this exist? Does it mean anything? It's a surprising and fun, I think, finding. I'm getting a bit ahead of myself, so I'll stick to the method. Now, this is just the first finding, 1216. The method is becoming refined. So there's likely to be hundreds, if not perhaps 1,000 more descriptors. I've signed recently a non-commercial license agreement with the Oxford English Dictionary. They sent me their entire list of adjectives from historical and modern day English. It was far more than I thought, so they sent it to me in an Excel sheet, and in column A of the Excel sheet, there's about 130,000 adjectives. And the next stage that I'd like to do in this research is basically populate the word democracy in column B. That would make a data set in the pre-positive position, and then inverse them in a different Excel sheet, and that would be in the post-positive position. Then run both through Google Scholar and Google Books using my instrument to detect the other adjectives that I haven't been able to find so far. I think that's good there. I should move on. This is the meaty part of the paper after we get through methodology. So Kirky is asking us about engagement, and that forms the heart of the question. So we've come up with one example, one delineated body of knowledge about democracy using adjectives. Now the question is, once we've got this list, what do we do with it? What value does that bring? And I've got five answers in particular. So the first way is to drill down. That would be the first application of this, which is literally to, you know, investigate the meaning of each of those 1216 entries to see what they're about. And the example I'll give today is brown democracy. So it's a bit of a story using pictures. So this is Carlos P. Romulo. He was a journalist in the 1930s, and he joined the Filipino army, going from colonel to, I think, brigadier general in the 1940s. And in 1943, he wrote this book, Mother America. In the book, he makes mention of brown democracy, which for him is a type of racial democracy that emerged from mainly Japanese propaganda. So as the Japanese Empire was expanding in East Asia and going further south, it was using this narrative of, you know, all Asians together, you know, all races in Asia unite to fight against, you know, Western colonial powers. And for Romulo, this was the only silver lining that had come out of the Japanese disaster. And it was, you know, basically the idea of a transboundary, pan-Asian, multinational democracy that would rise and emancipate the, you know, brown people, in his words, from colonial oppression, mainly Western colonial oppression, but of course Japan figured in it. Now this book prompted a response from an academic in 1944. So this is published in the Far Eastern Survey. I think defunct, stopped publishing in 62. But the debate centered around, you know, in part, this idea of brown democracy. So the academic felt that Romulo was being too Pollyannish, that this was, you know, you can't separate democracy from imperialism. If one power in Asia becomes the great democracy out of the rubble of war, then what's to stop it from just using its, you know, newfound capacity to dominate others in the region? Anyway, the point is to say that the book was published, it spurred this debate. It was about a silver lining that came out of the Japanese military expansion, and it was this really interesting idea of having a pan-Asian emancipatory democracy. Now, I wouldn't have found this story if I hadn't actually gone looking into brown democracy. And if you try to find other mentions of this in the literature, not actually, aside from one book, I think in 1988, no one's really written on this. It's just this story lost in time. And it makes, you know, I think it makes a really nice little narrative, and it raises some really interesting questions for those that are interested in the history of democracy or international studies. So the point here is that there are 1,200 or so inquiries that can be made by drilling down all of these different stories to be told. And, you know, like I mentioned before, looking at brown democracy can lead to uncovering questions about other types of colors, and you get these categories of meaning that emerge. The second way is to create taxonomies. Michel Foucault was quite influential for me here, so his Archaeology of Knowledge spoke very strongly to me. And the idea of the Archaeology of Knowledge is basically to not reduce things, knowledge, into simple forms, but really just to uncover structure in knowledge, and to basically figure out all the different ways that knowledge can be constructed, and to approach it with the eye of the archaeologist. So in the paper, I took the example of Lincolnian democracy. It's a very seldom used descriptor. From 1947 to 2010, it, as far as I could find, it's only been used 20 times across 18 different publications. Now, when I put them in an order like this, I started looking for linkages between these works, so citation networks and such. And it was odd for me because none of these works actually cite each other. They all come to use the word Lincolnian democracy, you know, for their own purposes, from their own perspectives. And a few of these works come from, you know, divergent fields of research. So what creating this taxonomy led me to do is to think, you know, really just about how knowledge sits about a descriptor. How can we, you know, make advances here? How can we uncover more about it? And anyway, it led me to play around with different ideas, and I ended up overlaying two different taxonomies, one for Lincoln's democracy, and one that was produced by doing a Boolean search of democracy and Lincoln in the title of works. And when you overlay them, what you see is you don't get a really strong narrative. There is no, you know, continuous line through these works showing that there's been a sustained discourse between the works on this idea of Lincolnian democracy. And so there's an opportunity there to go and give this genealogy, to go and pull these works together and give some kind of a meta narrative of what this is. The only point I would add to that is about families of meaning. So you can think of Wittgenstein in particular. So when you've got things like good democracy, good democracy can have its own synonyms, it can form its own family of meaning, it can pull these adjectives together, deconstruct its literature by doing these taxonomies, and then overlaying them, comparing them to try to see what might come from that in terms of where there are gaps. That's the main function of this, it's finding gaps in meta. The third way is, third application is meta theories of democracy. I had quite a lot of fun here. It's a little bit different, a little bit more creative than I think some of my colleagues used to. But what I did was I took 1216 different descriptors and I decided that I would visualize this body of knowledge. So I built a village digitally using Minecraft. So this isn't the actual village. I pilfered this picture from the net. But effectively, the way the village works is there are 1216 buildings. The buildings vary in size based on their score in the data set. So American Democracy is the biggest building in the village. And you know, Torpedo Boat Democracy is one of the smallest. And I got the idea to do this from Tocqueville, actually. So when Tocqueville returned from America in the early to mid 1800s, he had literally a trunk full of notes, of notebooks. And over the 8 years that or so that he worked on the book, he used a number of metaphors about how he can try to give coherence to this body of knowledge. And one of the metaphors that he used was that he pictured the concept of democracy in America as a great city. And like a traveler in a great city, he would walk away from it, climb a nearby hill, and then take in the view. And so I thought, gosh, well, maybe I could try doing this with this list. So I built the village. You can go in Minecraft and walk your little character to a nearby hill, look at it, and try to see what comes of it. The first impression is that it's big. There's literally so much included in that. The buildings, for instance, some of them have rooms in them. So adjectives, you can have first order adjectives, which would be representative democracy, and you can have second order adjectives, which would be liberal representative democracy. And second order adjectives figure as rooms inside the building. So some buildings have a number of rooms in them. And then you think about the people who actually wrote the words that were used to find these adjectives, so the authors of the words. And I started to wonder about villagers, how this people would actually walk through the village, who would meet, how many people would there be, and how they interact with villagers. So the finding, anyway, of the meta theory here is that there are at least four different types of author in the village. So some people describe democracy without the use of any pre- or post-falsative adjectives. This is quite rare. Another rare type is those who use one pre-falsative adjective in a work. So one scholar used industrial democracy in his book on industrial democracy. It was the only adjective he used. He used it, I think, 88 times, and that was it. The vast majority of people use two or more pre- and post-falsative adjectives when they're writing on democracy. And, for obvious reasons, no one has yet used all of the adjectives in an attempt to try to describe democracy. And so this actually is situated in a different paper, but I explore this implication of not having a type 4 author. So what does it mean if you don't have a person who tried to understand democracy by looking at all of its adjectives? And one answer that's come from that is that perhaps it could lead to creating a coherent narrative about democracy, one that is based on an empirically grounded body of knowledge. And to do this, you need to download a lot of optical character recognition compatible files. We're talking hundreds of thousands, if not more, books and journal articles, and then running using a software, a piece of software to run linguistic analysis to try to uncover meaning in this mass pile of data. Now the penultimate way or application is to rethink the phenomenology of democracy. Now, typically, I think we spend a lot of our time talking about democracy in Australia, American democracy, and when we do this, we're often using singulars. We speak about it in rather simplistic ways. But then this list, the 1216, it prompts a different type of thinking. What can be described, logic is, can also potentially be practiced. And it invites us to think deductively about democracies within a polity. So how many, for instance, of the 1216 would we find practiced in Australia? Or if not practiced, then at least thought of, right? How many people hold opinions that could be matched up with these different adjectives? And if we find 10 or 20 or 30 or more different iterations of democracy within a polity, what does that mean? Now, this isn't quite novel, I think, because we're really approaching that form of thinking already. So the varieties of democracy project, they've recently included, I think, 5 or 6 different principles of democracy in their measurements of democracy. And and again, I mentioned the scholars that are critical of democracy promotion, literature of export democracy, and so forth, who have always kind of understood that there are multiplicities of democracy, that there are many ways of practicing it, that your model over there, might be so good for us. Now this, what I wrote about here is just to say that some democracies complement each other, right? Deliberative democracy, monitory democracy, representative democracy, they needn't clash. They can often go together and support each other. And in that sense, the argument can be made that it builds resilience in the existing democratic system. Alternatively, you can have different conceptions of democracy that do clash, that rub up against each other. And we can think of those that are popular amongst young people, maybe resistive democracy or radical democracy, non-voting democracy, as being, in a sense, contrarian to electoral democracy. So these clashes create important sites. It opens sites for a type of politics. And here we can think of Pierre Rosabaron, who talks about democracy countering democracy. And anyway, this is just a way of rethinking how a regime can be democratic. Is its character something that comes from the number of different types of democracy that exist within its borders? And the final application for the list, which I think is probably quite obvious, is just that it's like a serendipitous research question generator. If you sit down with it and you just start flipping through it, it just raises a lot of questions, and I think it's quite good at doing this. For instance, what further theoretical inroads can be made about atomic democracy or nuclear democracy? Why is there literature on geographic democracy but not geologic democracy? And there's some really interesting work that geologic democracy, that term, would capture very well. My colleagues at the University of Canberra are looking at coal seam gas extraction in Australia, and the polity is actually defined by the gas field. It's a geological construct. That's how the polity, those affected by it, is formed. But no one has yet conceptualized geologic democracy, there lies another opportunity. And coming back to my favorite, what exactly is Sardinian democracy? And you get the point. It goes on and on and on. So I think I've perhaps battered your ears too much in my rather stilted tenor today. But the point that I would make about this is if you pull all the applications together, all it really is just a simple research program. It's just a different way of coming at democracy, and I think it's a productive one, and it's also a really fun space to be working in. So I might leave it there. Thank you for your time. Really appreciate it.
Questions?
I see the word pluralism as being divisive in order to manipulate, and the very word democracy is not a single word, it's a statement. It says people rule, and it's such a powerful statement that people who have self-interest, who want to take advantage of the situation and mislead and divert away from the actual essence of democracy, where people rule. This gives a acknowledgement of the importance and integrity of each individual man, that he is his own master, he is sui juris. So when you get a collection of men and they say, okay, we will rule, we will not be ruled, but we will rule. And so therefore, the word democracy will survive even in spite of all the attempts to destroy it, usurp it, whatever, you know. And I would like your comment on a phrase which I use all the time, and that is that trial by jury is democracy. Because in trial by jury, you have people and they make judgments and they make orders and they rule. So when you have trial by jury, that acknowledges the sovereignty of people over institutions or corporations or anything else which can be manipulated. Because when you have each individual man or each individual woman, they are guided by their conscience as to what is right and what is wrong. So surely democracy, the objective of democracy is to have rights protected, and in fact wrongs punished. So as far as the pluralism of using democracy and adding all these other words to it, I can only see that as being divisive. And I think even in the law there's a maxim that pluralism is repugnant to law. Because when you have law, you're seeking to implement justice. So as far as the system we have here in Australia, we are being diverted away from the actual essence of democracy, which is giving acknowledgement to each individual man as being a free man, and putting them into a disparate relationship to democracy. They say, okay, we'll have consultative democracy, we'll have representative democracy, we will not have democracy. So your talk is about adjective pluralism. So
let's jump over.
Yeah, thank you very much for your comment. I'm grateful. What came to mind is there is an adjective called a jury democracy, I believe, if I remember that.
John invented it.
And, look, from my point of view,
pluralism is something that, you know, I celebrate. And there is, you know, like I began to talk with, there are many rival claims to what democracy is or should be in that Platonic sense of an absolute claim. But they're all rival claims. There is no agreed definition of what it is. We just have a really big collection of them. And my colleagues actually say that's a good thing. And having this pluralism keeps, you know, democracy democratic. And anyway, there's a lot of nice work on democratizing democracy, which might be interesting. Well, thank you for your comment, Jim.
I'm just curious to know why you picked this as a subject for study. Is it because you're doing a paper and you pick the topic, or someone picked the topic for you? Or
it's because when I read the descriptor, which made me come here, I thought this is a strange thing to be studying, you know, the 1,200 adjectives for democracy. I thought to myself, yeah, so. So I'm curious to know why you've picked it, and I'm going to say, I mean, you're virtually, I think you're saying that in understanding all the various kinds of descriptors of democracy, we get a better understanding of them. But to tell you the truth, if you go out there in the real world and use the word democracy, people have got, they don't walk around with a dictionary in their head, they've just got their own sense of theory, which is it's government by the people, for the people. But at the end of the day, living in a democracy, you know, it just means we go every so often to vote, and half the time we don't even know who we're voting for, we don't even know the people. So I don't know that actually. So I'm confused to know why you picked this topic, and whether it was you picked it or it was kind of you were asked to do it.
Now I take full responsibility for this work. The question of why, it honestly, it was just curiosity. So you're reading things like, you know, I mentioned Henry Mayo, who started off his book in the preface by saying, you know, instinctively he wanted to count the medley of democratic theories and come at it that way. Or you go to Dahl, who says, well, it's, you know, it'd be great to know these things, but it's not really practicable. We've got to start somewhere. And you just keep running into these admissions. That was, I think, the real linchpin for me, that scholars kept saying, there are many, there are hundreds. Well, how many? It's just a basic empirical question. You know, how many are out there in the English language? How many are out there in other languages? And when I got to that point, then I started to think more practically about it. Well, what exactly does this mean? You know, the so what question. And what I came to is, at this point, just these five applications. And so in a sense, it's kind of self-serving, because it's, you know, programmatic, and it just establishes a type of research agenda. But then, you know, if you think about Sartori's work, or again, what you know, Amelia was saying, I'll start with Sartori. He says that definitions are important. Words matter. And if we don't exactly know or have an empirical grounding of knowledge about something, then what is it that we're talking about? And I know there are convincing arguments for why we don't really need this. The only answer that I have, so let's say the difference between defined democracy without this data set or a much better version in the future, or doing it with it, is kind of like an archaeologist picking up maybe a potsherd and trying to analyze the sherd without the rest of the pot. It just limits your functions. But if you've got the rest of the pot, if you've got some idea of where this comes from, how it compares to other things, if you're pulling it from what is or an approximation of what is, then your analysis is just not that limited. And that's really as far as I got. And then, you know, Amelia would say scholars are implicitly advancing particular conceptions of democracy at the expense of others. And the way I read this is we're doing that just because we don't perhaps know what's out there. That if we knew more about what is, what exists, we might be a bit more, I don't know, conscientious of the effect that we have in advancing this conception of democracy and not that one. When it comes to people out on the street and just common understandings, you know, the meaning of democracy changes, right, from time to time and place to place. I think of Dorrit Spleet's work. She's based in the Netherlands, and she's got some really interesting empirical work where she basically asks people in polities what democracy is, how they understand it, and again, what comes out of that is this pluralism. That, you know, it's actually quite difficult to distill what a common conception is because people have these rival ideas of what a democracy should be or what it is, whether they're actually living in a democracy or whether democracy is on the horizon. And yeah, so I think maybe if we had a better understanding of the layout of knowledge about democracy, then we could just use it to better understand what's happening today.
Also, I was thinking, it's true that people might say that there was just one God and so on and so forth, but the reality that there are actually more, there's much more than that, because then you see outside, especially in the last 5 or 6 years since the global economic crisis, that in fact people do have different understanding of democracy, do develop a bit more a problematic definition of democracy. That is not enough just to go involved, so you actually have to redefine the system. The discussion this very moment in America and the unhappiness of the two candidates does in fact mirror the kind of dissatisfaction with the simplistic approach to democracy as we just go to vote and now and nothing else. So there's a bit more than that. And I think it's, but I don't agree with your question, but the whole point is like, is this all semantics or is just, or there's something more in there? And I think that usually there's a chance. I see you raise your hand. So that's okay. But I'm taking my position of chair to speak. I think there is the first risk, the first impression is always what we do, what is this semantics, so what. But when we are talking, question that came to me, one issue came to my mind is that it's interesting to see maybe what is it, who drives the dialogue in the topic of democracy. And we're only interested in that dialogue about what kind of qualitative dialogue is this. So, for instance, and John and I have been working on a research project on China, for instance, and on China linked to democracy. And the issues there, usually we speak about democracy, we speak about the liberal or American style democracy. So, this can give you a very good sense, I think, for example, what John Paul is doing, a very good sense of maybe the dialogue. In the literature, not only the literature, also at the political sphere, about what is democracy or not, is actually driven by specific idea developed in specific countries, for instance. So maybe the village would be very interesting to see, because then you get a sense of who is actually driving this dialogue. The problem you have there, too, and I was wondering about this when you were talking, is that the methodology and your sources are very important. It depends on which one you're looking at. So you didn't say much about how you pull all these terms. I don't know whether my question would be like this. Are you speaking, are you looking just at the titles? Are you looking at the full text? How the texts are blending with each other? And I think, for instance, with the title, you might want to give a couple of points to it, because clearly it's a major point. The title would be a chapter. The main idea, you can sit through all these words. And then what is it say to us about the fact that you need to have a soundbite to be able to sell a book to be quoted? But doesn't say much about the fact that actually there is something in there. So I say one of the uses.
Great, thank you. So the search, when it goes through the scrolling from the books, it goes through all of the available text. So some of the the literature that's included in the score will actually be just useless. It'll be, you know, a reference, just a footnote, but there's just so much volume.
But this becomes fast positive for you, doesn't give you a better sense of what
yeah,
is
yeah,
so
yeah.
You're suffering, you might want to know you're suffering, you might want to come up with a more specific database choice.
Yeah, so this is more of a second order bit of work. So the first thing that I'd like to do is just to get a better version of this list, and then it's about downloading as much of the compatible literature for each of the entries as possible, and having those in a data bank. And then, you know, it's about finding the appropriate literature, cleaning it, and having these debates as to what counts as a contribution to a particular description.
What about more academic databases? What about JSTOR or other databases that you, that maybe more academics use to the Google score?
Which is not as capacious.
Yeah, but you really need to put them together in the sense that you need to make sure you have all of this in your benchmarks.
I actually think Google Scholar does include JSTOR and these other indexes.
I don't know.
Yeah. And yeah, when it comes to just analyzing works, that's kind of the next stage of the project, which requires building this library.
Because you mentioned, and then you mentioned the Foucault method, but you know, in the cases also which I liked how we come up with some ideas and how these ideas actually impose it. So you didn't really say much about that. I think if you really have this village, the village you have this major American democracy. If you really make it even more precise as a village and figure out whether or not there's some plus positive benefit or not, what is the impact of this literature, then you might have a sense that there's been in a kind of imposition or predominance of this idea that has led to less to be more less possibilities of exploring new avenues. Mm-hmm. When it's about democracy, for instance. Mm-hmm. And then we cut and choose what's democracy and authoritarianism, mm-hmm. and nothing less than the truth.
Well, thank you very much, Jean-Paul. I have a double-barreled comment. You've heard me say this before. One has to do with the point that's raised by the gentleman with the Southern Cross flag on his shirt. Is the point, what's the point of this? And the other closely related are the proposed methods that you're using. On the point, you say that it's driven by curiosity. We know that curiosity can kill cats.
Wisdom may be found. Wisdom may be found.
And I see in your draft, but also in this talk, highlighted three possibilities, and you need to make up your mind about what is the point. I don't think you can embrace all three at once, but I think you do, intended or not. One, I'll put it harshly, is the first option is that what you want is a general theory of descriptors of democracy that lead to some kind of general knowledge coherent, I'm quoting you, that leads to the uncovering of the meaning of democracy, these are all your phrases, of knowing what's out there. You want a Bolshevik, you set yourself up as a Bolshevik know-all who wants, using methods I'll mention in a moment, to stand on the mountain and look down, actually to stand at the top of your village, it's actually a city, to look down on the myriad of usages so that you can tell us what this all means. This is one point, or one aim, it seems to me, implicit or if not explicit in what you say. The second possibility is that actually, without intending it, this is a kind of an example of the theatre of the absurd. It highlights the meaninglessness of this signifier democracy. There are 1,216, probably many more. Of course, you're dealing with written texts, and there were times when it was only oral, and you can't get to those. But the point is that you are one effect, possibly unintended. You're playful, you're curious, but one possible effect is that this drives the signifier towards over the cliff of meaningfulness. One could draw the conclusion that it's just all a swirling mass of adjectives, and you compound that by actually granting to each signifier, your rule is one signifier, one vote, one score on the list. Third possibility is that you have a sense of urgency about why you're doing this, and I don't think that is very strong at all. I think that you could say in your defense that a third aim is that you are against essentialist definitions of democracy of the kind that John put, that you're anti-Bolshevik in the sense that you want to show that one thing that's unusual about democracy as a way of life is that it does enable, it does create spaces in which there are contests about the meaning of the signifier, and hence the pluralization. And through time, this would be a most interesting thesis, but it's absent. Through time, you know, democracy does pluralize itself. Now, missing from your account, I think, this is still the third possibility, is that it might be good for a democracy to have a contest of meanings of what democracy is. This would be your case for pluralism. But, you know, there are difficulties here because there were great historical clashes, and there's a great historical clash emerging in our times between different understandings of democracy. It's a political matter that, you know, produced bloodshed in the past. So that's just a very rough comment about what I think is at least three possibilities. They are incommensurable, and you need to make up your mind about why you're doing this. It's not enough to say that you're curious, or it's not enough to say this is fun. That's actually pretty unpersuasive. And particularly when you get out there in the real world, mentioned by our man with the Southern Cross, you know, it's a much more rough and tumble. This is so you know, these are three, it seems to me, possibilities. Linked to this, secondly, is I think a confusion in your methodology. There are people saying that we've entered times where there's a great clash between data and narration. You know, the collection of data is clearly a goal of many institutions, the NSA, Google, and so on. But what it means, and the purposes for which it's used, are unclear, and there is serious scholarship in the field of communications that is highlighting this replacement of storytelling, narration, interpretation, and so on the one hand, with data. And I think that your whole approach is torn between these two. You have an aesthetic fascination with collecting names as if they were butterflies. And it's all, this is the one signifier, one vote, one score on the list. And what you are doing is that you're proceeding inductively, not deductively, by the way, that's a misdescription of what you're doing. You're proceeding inductively. This is democracy adjective one, this is democracy adjective 2, and you get up to 1216, it's not clear where that will lead you, but that is the logic of induction, and it's, in other words, you're using a pretty straight, I would say pretty unsophisticated empirical method, empiricism. It's almost 19th century, because as you know, in the field of the sciences, no scientist anymore has believed in this method for nearly 100 years. Every data collection is itself structured by concepts, by a language, by an attribution of significance to an object, and it's not clear, rebalancing this first big comment. So you have an empiricist method. On the other hand, there are moments when you, every example you gave illustrates that you call it archaeology. There's a like, you're engaged in a kind of anthropology of meaning. Take the case of Romulan, was it?
Yep.
The brown democracy, it's very interesting. As the more you spoke, the more you revealed that actually that signifier, that adjective, is born of a context. There are works and there are replies to it, and it raises very interesting questions about the impact of Japanese imperialism and so on and so forth. There the method is that the signifier is caught up in a language field which itself is lived in a set of institutions at a particular time and place. And this means that the drilling down, to use your metaphor, is not empirical observation in the first sense. It's actually a species of interpretation, as every anthropologist knows. And you need to make up your mind about which of these methods you are using. The difficulty is that you cannot do, in a lifetime, 1,216 anthropological field trips. You cannot. Every anthropologist will tell you that you just do one of these and it'll take you a lifetime. This raises the question, which one would you choose? And we're back to the problem of why it is that we were doing this. One last comment about all of this. So I think a double-barreled comment about the tension in your methods, the way that mirrors a tension in what the hell this is all about. A very sobering book, I don't know if you know, is and a great book, which is, it takes you a while to read, is Umberto Eco's Kant and the Platypus. I don't know if any of you know it. Did anybody ever read it? It's a wonderful book. At the end of the 18th century, Europeans who come to this part of the world discover a new species, a new adjective of animal. And the English adventurers, colonizers, say that it is a water mole. And there is basically, as Eco shows, almost a generation-long dispute about what this object is. And it defies all taxonomies, though those who think it's an English water mole put it into that box. And there is an almighty row with a lot of ink spilled and a lot of reputations damaged. A power struggle unfolds about how to name this object. And why are they doing this? Because they are doing it either to defend an existing taxonomy of living species or to amend that taxonomy. There's a point to what they're doing. But what Eco shows is that any naming of an object is itself an immensely power-ridden process of handling language in a context of meanings, contested meanings, where power relations infuse contexts. And the whole thing, as you will see from him, is arbitrary, to be sure. That was your opening point. There's nothing in itself, there's nothing in the platypus that names it as a platypus. It does not wear a sign around its neck saying, "I am a platypus." It's a human name given. So it's a whole politics of cognition. And I think that you need to make up your mind as to what you're doing. If you if you accept the echo approach, then you will, so to say, stop this descriptivism, where you're fascinated by 1216 because it's in some ways an absurd. It's a species of the theater of the absurd. It will take us nowhere. The echo approach forces you to think about power and signifiers and language context and the flow of time, and it would therefore raise the question of why is it that in certain contexts particular definitions of democracy with adjectives prevail. I think your top 10 hit list is very revealing. I mean, we could have a discussion as to why American democracy is number one. I wonder why. It's complicated, and you would have to give a whole. But it would be much more interesting if you did that. It would be much more interesting if you used this as your, you know, introduction, where you move then to a key point that American democracy is the most commonly occurring adjectival species of democracy, and then begin your narrative from there. We'll talk about it much more, I'm sure, but I hope they're tough, but they're helpful.
Thanks. I'm very grateful for all of that. I mean, it's a lot for me to go over. And I think, ultimately, that there is a resistance in me to make, I guess, make a position in this work. So I'm really trying.
Sure. That's why I put the points.
Yeah, but it's kind of, haven't we always been doing this in a sense? Not just letting an empirical finding, as you know, as simple as it is, just speak for itself.
Well, the point, if you're a Foucauldian, or if you're